Hello and welcome to the Bazura Project and our guide to cinema. That's cinema with an S, because we'll never let good grammar get in the way of a stupid pun butt. And tonight's show is the most kinful of all. It's all about violence. Yes, from hilarious eye gouging and bloodless shootouts to slow motion chest wounds and pretenders who think more is more, we'll examine violence in the cinema as if Shannon's life depended on it.
Where should we start? I mean, you know, film violence is such a broad topic. There's so much to cover. Please don't kill me. I still don't understand why there were killer plants that are happening.
So perhaps a quick overview of movie violence is necessary, just to give you a leg up. And what better place to start than the source of all our earliest violent impulses?
Violence in the cinema has been around precisely one day earlier than violence ever appearing in real life. Early cave drawings suggest Cro-Magnon man created the first ever war after watching the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
So, like its parents, theatre and literature, cinema was both illegitimate and violent from the get-go.
A Trip to the Moon featured a severe ocular trauma in graphic close-up. The Sprinkler Sprinkled shows a callous hose-related attack on a public servant, and employees leaving the Lumiere factory provoked its audience to violence for being really, really boring.
These challenging portrayals of artistic expression started our kids down a moral sewer towards the treatment plant of spiritual bankruptcy. But in amongst the turds of despair came a corn kernel of hope. And Hollywood certainly didn't remember eating that.
A production code was instituted in 1930, a series of rules restricting what could and couldn't be shown in your film.
Even specific filmmaking techniques had to be altered. The code wouldn't allow the shooter and the victim to be in the same frame.
But the code was more worried about films directly inspiring or teaching its audience how to commit crimes. So criminals could never be portrayed as sympathetic or heroic. Staple gangster films like Public Enemy, Scarface, and Staple Gangster got away with having very charismatic villains and showing a ton of violence because the bad guys always died in the end. Hammering home to the audience that crime doesn't pay.
Because good writers are expensive, fake blood is cheap, and audiences are a bunch of brainless monkeys, Hollywood kept churning out violent movies, and few filmmakers had as big an impact on cinematic violence as Alfred Hitchcock. The shower scene in Psycho was a big turning point for movie violence. As intense as this scene was, there were only 3 frames of the knife penetrating the skin. Sound effects and audience inference were used to create the effect. But the reason Hitchcock's violence had such an impact wasn't the stabbing in the shower, but rather the tension created as the figure is seen approaching. As Hitchcock himself said, there is no terror in the bang, only in the anticipation of it. A sentiment also shared by my ex-girlfriend.
After Psycho, not to be confused with the TV spin-off, many more films continued to push the boundaries of violence.
Are you sure we're doing the right thing, Tom?
Well, the television said that's the right thing to do.
And in 1968, the code was abandoned in favour of a rating system, allowing filmmakers to continue to push the boundaries of violence once more, but this time with a random letter attached.
If they move, kill them.
Filmmakers of the 1970s were inspired by the horrors of the Vietnam War to use graphic violence as a metaphor for graphic violence.
Say goodbye, Creed.
In the 80s, cinema became much more kiddie-friendly, and a cartoonish approach to violence was introduced, where mass murder was perfectly acceptable, as long as you were a muscle-bound hero type with snappy catchphrases.
Happy trails, Hans.
And magic guns with unlimited bullets.
David Cronenberg's Scanners wasn't really a turning point in cinema history, but it would be remiss of us to not show you this. Outstanding. In the 21st century, society reached its zenith with the creation of torture porn. This subgenre includes films such as Hostel, Saw, and The Passion of the Christ. Wow, Mel Gibson must really hate carpenters. Any questions? Weren't there a whole bunch of kids here before?
It all began when I was a child. Our strict classification system kept me away from anything that might permanently damage me or take away my innocence, namely sex. But I didn't really mind because of all the violent films that were available to me.
At first, the violence was really shocking. Even the slightest bruising would make me ill. But something changed. I could watch people feast on one another's limbs and remain totally unfazed.
It was all fine until my desensitization spilled over into my real life.
Oh, please. None of this is remotely realistic. That blood's the wrong colour for a start.
I even stopped noticing when it happened to me.
Sorry, guys, not buying it. First of all, that's not what bones sound like when they break. Second of all, if I'd actually lost that much blood, I'd have passed out by now. Think about it. Now, you guys go get your act together. And I'm gonna have a little lay down.
I thought I'd hit the limit, but there was still one place left for me to go. I became violent myself.
So, Mr. Zachariah, regarding your loan application.
Yes?
I'm happy to report it's been approved.
Oh, that's fantastic news. Oh, sorry. That's awkward. We're still cool, right? Doctor, I need to know. Am I crazy?
No. Well, this is a bit excessive, don't you think? Ow! Is that vinegar? Good one, Dick. J.W. Gacy writes, "Hey guys, I love your show, especially the part where you use letters from the public to set up segments in a particularly contrived way. But tell me something, how would I go about creating my own violent scene in a movie I'm apparently making? As we've learned so far, it's very difficult to sustain drama without copious amounts of blood. So if you want to make a compelling film, you're gonna have to have some violence in it. And here's how you do it. Violence in movies always falls into three categories. Funny, benign, and so over the top it completely negates its own point. Funny violence is probably the oldest of all. Slipping on a banana peel, getting kicked in the crotch. Funny violence is laughing at someone in pain.
This kind of violence can be traced back to vaudeville-inspired early cinema, and all the greats embraced it. Chaplin, Keaton, Laurel and Hardy, the Marx Brothers, and the Three Stooges. Although, they were all a great deal funnier than this.
Kids' films typically use a lot of funny violence. Got to know where the line is, though. Kids assaulting adults is fine, but the other way around...
Yes!
Just be careful.
Most of the time, you'll want to use benign violence, often described as action. This too has been around forever. You can even chart the history of action films through examples of benign violence. Cowboys versus Indians, cops versus robbers, superheroes versus supervillains, vampires versus werewolves, benign violence is all about no blood, no pain, and no consequences. Exactly what you want your children growing up to believe. Then there's over-the-top violence, where nothing is left to the imagination. Because frankly, your imagination is never going to be as cool as Eli Roth's. You can have blood and guts and bones, oh my, all on display, there's nothing off limits. You can even show Mickey Rourke in close-up.
I'm an old broken down piece of meat.
Oh, humanity!
If you're making a horror film, this is the kind of violence you want. It used to be enough with just monsters stabbing people, but nowadays audiences want more inventive killings.
Good morning. The device on your head will crush your skull in 3 minutes. To stop the device, you must find the key. The key is in your stomach. Your stomach is in that man over there. There is a hacksaw inside the toolbox. The toolbox is in your skull. Your time starts now.
If you're making a war movie in this day and age, you need to make it as gritty and in-your-face as possible. Films like Platoon, Saving Private Ryan, and Black Hawk Down have shown us that even war has its ugly side. You can get away with just about anything, so long as you can claim some historical or educational context. Pick any random war, throw in some cheap subtext about patriotism, and you can show all the blood you want. And that's how you make a violent movie scene. The only thing left is how to make fake movie blood.
Yes, I'm glad you asked that statement, Lee. The recipe for realistic blood is really simple. All you need is some chocolate sauce, some food dye, and some human blood. So just roll up your sleeve, give me your arm there. Now, this is gonna hurt me a lot more than it hurts you.
Really?
No. Yes, we've certainly had a lot of fun here tonight. And there certainly are a lot of violent films around. And everyone knows the key ones.
A Clockwork Orange, Bonnie and Clyde, Cannonball Holocaust, I Spit on Your Grave.
But what about the lesser known films that people generally ignore because they're ignorant to anything not in English, not in colour, and not playing at their local multiplex? I'm not talking about you, of course. But I probably am. So here's four forgotten films featuring a bit of the old ultra-violence. Now, we could do four forgotten violent films purely from Japan. We could do this whole series just using films from Japan, purely as a warning of what 2,500 years of oppression will do to you. But I'll only include one here, and it's not really forgotten, but it's simultaneously the most graphic, ungraphic, and literally graphic death scene you'll ever see from Takashi Miike's Dead or Alive 2, Birds.
Nande na mara!
Actually, you can pretty much choose any Miike film and be guaranteed some insane violence. Audition, Ichi the Killer, Fudo, visit a queue you don't even want to see. And another non-recommendation I'm recommending is the notorious 1976 film Snuff. An American producer named Alan Shackleton bought some dodgy, low-budget South American horror film called Slaughter. And shot a new ending which showed the crew killing the lead actress.
Shit, we ran out of film. Shit.
Did you get it? Did you get it on?
Yeah, we got it on. Yeah, let's get out of here.
He never confirmed the scene was real, but never denied it either, resulting, of course, in people banging down the theatre doors on opening night and a massive box office take, despite the fact that the whole thing looks less realistic than the giant claw.
A depressingly great example of how the production code affected violent films is Mervyn LeRoy's The Bad Seed.
I thought I'd seen some mean little gals in my time, but you're the meanest.
It's about an 8-year-old girl named Rhoda who runs around killing her classmates and her neighbours with this oh-so-sweet sugar and spice facade, and it's actually pretty chilling.
What happened to old Mrs. Post in Wichita?
There was ice on the steps, and I slipped and fell against her, and that was all.
That was all?
No. I slipped on purpose.
Now, in the original play, Rhoda gets away with it all, but the production code wouldn't allow that, so the ending was changed to something a bit more biblically judgmental. And speaking of children getting what's coming to them, let's finish with the inspirational in all the wrong ways animated kids film The Brave Little Toaster, which is basically Toy Story with appliances. There's an air conditioner who gets so angry he kills himself.
Poor air conditioner.
I didn't know he'd take it so hard.
Well, he was a jerk anyway.
And a wonderfully uplifting song called Worthless. Set in a junkyard where broken cars sing about being unloved and obsolete, one car drives into the car crusher on purpose in a proud moment of suicide. You're worthless. But what's more damaging? Teaching kids that kissing a sleeping girl is okay? That changing your physical appearance will get you the man of your dreams? The teapots can sing. You decide. What's next? Impossible. 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 It's impossible to switch on a TV, switch on a movie, or switch on a book without seeing violence. But why is that? And what is violence?
Chambers' English Dictionary defines violence as a musical instrument with four strings played with a bow. So why does it permeate so much of our cinema?
We asked an actor pretending to be a professor of cinema studies.
Violence has been with us since the dawn of storytelling. Look at the Greeks.
All right. I don't get it.
No, I meant look at ancient Greeks.
How you doing?
When storytelling as we know it today first began, writers such as Sophocles, Euripides, Homer, all used violence in their storytelling. It's instantaneous conflict, understandable in any language. It's even in the greatest story ever told.
Rocky.
Yes.
Many stories that preceded Rocky, such as the Bible and the works of William Shakespeare, were also filled with murder, torture, rape, and hair-pulling. Given all our culture stems from these works, it's no wonder our best writers can't resist inserting a quick stabbing into otherwise dull scenes. So, actor playing a professor, we see copycat killings all the time. How can you possibly claim that violent movies don't create real-world violence?
You told me what to say.
I know, this is part of it. Just...
Oh, sorry. Violent movies do not cause violent behaviour. At the most, they are a trigger for pre-existing violent tendencies.
But then, should not the trigger itself be banned for inciting such violence?
Well, that's all I've got. There aren't any more pages. Anything can be a... What? Oh, a trigger. Catcher in the Rye. Jodie Foster. Really? And nobody is suggesting that these things are dangerous.
Interesting. We showed a room full of volunteers several violent films in a row. Salo, Audition, I Spit on Your Grave, Maskhead, Forrest Gump, and came back 12 hours later to observe the results. So, how did everybody... Huh. So why have violence in film at all? What use does it have?
Well, it can be a catharsis, a way of working through the problems and issues in our lives by the observation of very primitive and instinctive acts.
So would you say that there is no direct link between violent films and violent behaviour?
Well, that's not the case at all.
No. I mean, would you say that?
There is no direct link between violent films and violent behaviour?
I see. The issue of violence in cinema and the impact it has on the viewer is a very serious one. It's an extremely complex and often controversial topic that inspires much debate on all sides, and as such, deserves a lot more care than the segment you just watched.
Yeah, what we just showed you was rubbish. That was a waste of time.
Sorry. Say, Shannon, have you ever wondered what violence will look like in the future? Violence in the future.
What's that? Don't just rub your chin and look wistfully off into the distance.
I'm bleeding.
You, have you ever wondered what violence is like in the future?
Yes, I have. Please don't hurt me.
Yes, the future, yes.
Greetings, Earthlings.
Greetings, weird space person. We come in peace.
It's okay, I'm here. Thanks for waiting. I had to take the long way.
Oh, great, whoever you are. What will violence look like in the future?
Much as the movies of your time predicted, guns will be replaced with various forms of laser beams. This is a far less gruesome way of killing people, as it prevents blood from messing up the place. Instead, organs are fried internally, making for a pleasant corpse.
So murder is still only a 1-to-1 ratio? We do away with mass killings?
That is correct. That is incorrect. Films have accurately depicted what genocide in the future will look like, and this, too, is now suitable for a PG audience. Entire planets can now be destroyed from a great distance.
What is it?
I felt a great disturbance in the Force, as if millions of voices...
Do not interrupt me with copyrighted speeches!
Sorry.
And now to send you back to the past, by inflicting violent head trauma upon you...
So Mark Twain was right.
If anyone asks, you walked into a doorframe.
Oh, great, you changed history.
How do we do that from the future?
What are we lining up for?
The Bazura Project Awards, where the winner of the violence category is only a few rels from being announced. The decorations here tonight are outstanding, with the automatic machine guns that fire whenever they sense movement being shipped in from the set of Aliens. Now, needless to say, it has caused some problems on the carpet, which is most definitely running red tonight. But let's cross now to the live ceremony with host Shannon Marinko, Lee Zachariah, and the quintessential Violence in Film Award.
Violence is everywhere in cinema, from the artiest movie to the lowest common denominatoriest action film to children's entertainment. There's nothing human beings love more than watching one another get tortured.
And torture is what comes to mind when we think of tonight's nominees. We are here to pay tribute to the film that, above all others, defined violence on the screen. And the nominees are...
For most enduring violent influence, causing an entire generation of wannabe filmmakers to employ excessively slow-motioned gunfights, John Woo.
For
for best backfiring attention to detail, with violence so graphic the director was brought up on murder charges, cannibal holocaust.
Watch it, Alan, I'm shooting. Oh, good Lord!
For the most horrific non-horror film that forced Wes Craven to actually walk out in disgust, Reservoir Dogs.
For the film with the highest body count, with 836 on-screen deaths, the family-friendly Lord of the Rings Return of the King Extended Edition.
And for the lamest ever threat of physical violence, Vinnie Jones in Swordfish.
You eyeball me once more, boy, and I'll stick it so far up your ass, you'll be begging me for this bullet.
Terrible.
And the winner is The Most Dangerous Game of All. What's that?
Shannon?
I know what it is. It's like a trick question, you know. What is the most dangerous game of all? Oh, I know this, I know this, I know this.
Oh, God. Shannon!
No, that's not it. Rhinoceroses! No, no, no. Scrabble! Scrabble's pretty hard. Jenga?
And short of giving you the torrent addresses for a whole bunch of snuff movies that we totally don't have, I made that up. Please don't go near my computer until I get home. That's something you may want to know about violence in the cinema.
On next week's show, we look at another source of cinematic sinfulness, sex. And if tonight's show is anything to go by, it's our best episode yet.
So, what have we learned? Well, I've learned that movies don't make psychos, movies make psychos more creative. I've learned that violence in film is okay as long as it's presented in the most exciting and imitable way possible.
And I've learned that you can always rely on your fellow man to help you.
How did you get out? Oi, Chuckles, are you missing somebody?
No, come on. No, oh, go away!
So, until next time, psychopaths, sign off catchphrase.